Hi everyone, I hope this is getting recorded right now. Thank you for taking the time to learn about OpenEBS and what's come in the 3.0 release. I'm Kiran Mova. I'm one of the maintainers of the OpenEBS project, and I'm currently working at MyData. Before we get into the details about OpenEBS, just a few coordinates on how to reach us and what's been the journey for OpenEBS like. OpenEBS was created by MyData and donated to CNCF in May 2019. It's a sandbox project at the moment, and we are on Kubernetes Slack, where you can reach out to us on either OpenEBS channel or OpenEBS dev channel. Since donating to this CNCF, we have had a uptick in the number of community members using the product or contributing to the project. We also have public references of how customers use or users use this project. You can check that out in the links provided in this slide. This one is shows the analytics that we have on how many clusters get deployed that run OpenEBS on them. And we have seen a tremendous growth, it's a steady growth in terms of the number of clusters having OpenEBS. Quickly recap on what OpenEBS is and what's the problem it really solves for the users. This is a reference architecture for the storage stack for the cloud native workloads that was presented by CNCF. Tag for storage, and OpenEBS sits into the just above the storage systems, which is basically your hardware devices, and it has two components called as control plane and data engines, which are responsible for providing volume services. So it could be anything from aggregating the storage from the devices and presenting it as volumes, or performing snapshot or clone kind of capabilities. OpenEBS supports local and distributed block storage, and OpenEBS is tightly integrated into Kubernetes. It is in fact an Kubernetes add-on. And the control plane of OpenEBS helps you integrate the operational aspects into the framework or tools that the enterprises already have. If you look at the technology radar, storage typically means the data platforms or the products that are used in the data platforms, and those actually need some kind of an underlying block volumes or persistent volume planes, or persistent volumes if you are in the Kubernetes world, that have certain characteristics that are around availability, consistency, durability, and how easy it is to use them. So I did mention OpenEBS is tightly integrated into Kubernetes, and it really works for stateful workloads that are moving towards Kubernetes. And it's a fair question to ask, are stateful workloads really moving into Kubernetes, or why they are moving into the Kubernetes? This is a talk that was presented at the last KubeCon, and there's actually a follow-up talk again that's coming up in the North America KubeCon. The Flipkart here is one of the largest customer or the user of OpenEBS. The reasons for them to shift stateful workloads to Kubernetes is the same reasons why stateless workloads move as well. It's about trying to have a common abstractions that can enable you to move the workloads across different clouds, even from on-prem to cloud, etc. And then also ability to easily automate the process of deploying and maintaining them, which comes inherently by using the declarative way of doing things with Kubernetes. They claim to have an increased developer productivity, where you don't have to wait for infrastructure to provide the storage, rather it's a kind of automated. And there are enhancements that are planned as we get into the OpenEBS 3.1 and ahead. You'll notice that we are enhancing the data engines that we have for improved availability and resilience, right? Just to recap, I think there has been a shift in terms of how customers are looking, or like users are looking at deploying their stack, and in part it's due to the nature of like new processes, new technologies, new hardware tools that are available, and also like the new policies, like, you know, it could be like government policies around data that have come in, which require you to redesign the systems as well, right? So in fact, like as part of this redesign, like there are like varied types of stateful workloads that are emerging, some that could be called as standalone, which need a lot of like traditional storage services, but also like a cloud native kind of workloads that build, that have a lot of capabilities that typically are done by the underlying storage built into them. So what this means is, like, you know, they really need like fast and local storage, and resiliency, replication, high availability are taken care of by those workloads itself, right? And when we want to design storages for the new kind of applications that have come up, it's inevitable to kind of redesign the data engines, but along with the data engines comes the control plane. And the control plane has a lot of similarities with the aspects that Kubernetes already provides. And Kubernetes has evolved into this universal control plane that doesn't just orchestrate containers anymore. It goes on to like orchestrate virtual machines or anything. And in our case, we have made Kubernetes orchestrate the volumes. So this is like a typical storage stack with OpenEBS, which is something which is kind of like analogous to what you have seen with the reference architecture. They're like a control plane and a data engine components, and the control plane and the data engine components are all like deployed as containers. There is no dependency on like the platforms. You can kind of like declaratively make them run on any kind of platform. And the data engines itself, like again, like can be divided into two, like I said before, around like local and replicated. So the local volumes are for those workloads that just need fast storage, and there is no component of OpenEBS that comes in the data part. It just uses like the standard libraries available in the Linux. It could be like directly creating a subdirectory and using it, or it could be like using a raw device to creating volumes on LVM or ZFS and then using them as local volumes. So there is no resiliency that can be put in place by using LVM and ZFS, but the workloads are like directly getting the storage from the local storage. In case of like workloads that need some durable volumes, where like, you know, you need to sustain the failure of a node and like be highly available, OpenEBS supports this concept called as replicated volumes. Actually, you know, if you kind of same as distributed volumes, but I'll get into in a bit on why we call them as replicated. So these distributed block volumes, the applications write to something we call as target, or like, you know, in the MySTOR speak, it's called as a Nexus, that in turn writes the data to the local replica or the local storage, as well as synchronously replicates to other nodes. So the way this replication is done is different than a typical like distributed system, where like, you know, blocks are typically sharded across multiple nodes in a distributed system. But in case of OpenEBS, the entire volume data is available on a single node, and it also gets replicated to the other nodes, right? So that's why we call them as replicated volumes. And there are advantages to doing this, which, you know, this like lower metadata overhead that is involved in writing to a particular volume. It's just about like maintaining the replicas and where their replicas are located. It also helps in recovery of like the replicas when a node goes out of the cluster and comes back in. The rebuilding will only be from the nodes where the complete data is there. So it doesn't really impact all the nodes in the cluster to rebuild a volume. Right. So just in terms of like, you know, to drive home that concept, local volumes are for pods with the data written to only one node. And if that node goes out of the cluster, then that pod cannot be rescheduled to another nodes, and you basically are stuck with it. So typically like stateful sets that can handle resiliency are like a good case. Sometimes machine learning jobs are also like a good use cases for using the local volumes, especially like, you know, if there is like enough data that's been written into the local volume, and it's better to wait for the node to get restarted and start the job there rather than like kick-starting that job on some other nodes, right? So the option is for running a pod with a volume that's all local to the storage. In case of like distributed, the PV sends the data to a container, which we call as a container attached storage volume, or like a target pod that's an OpenEBS container that in turn replicates the data to multiple nodes. So if one of the node fails, that can be that pod can run on some of the other nodes here. So this just shows that. So these are like, just getting into like differences between like these local volumes and replicated volumes that I've just covered. So one thing to call out, apart from the benefits that we talked about, a limitation is because of the replicated nature of the volumes, is volumes can support a capacity that can all be accommodated into a single node as we don't shard it, right? And we have so far seen very less use cases in the cloud native space that really need volumes that go beyond like what can be afforded by beyond what's available on a local node, right? And of course, like Retread, the mini is supported by NFS natively by OpenEBS, and we think like the trend is actually moving towards object storage for any kind of like Retread mini use cases going forward. This one actually just tries to capture like, what's the typical user journey, or like, what are the personas of OpenEBS. The OpenEBS is targeted to like a different types of people. Like, it's for the developers who just want to quickly start with running their stateful workloads in a mini cube, or like, in a single cluster that they have with like local storage, or like even a three node cluster. And it's pretty easy to get started. And the one of the things that we focused on really providing that first 15 minutes experience where you can just install OpenEBS like any other Kubernetes application and get started. So we noticed that a lot of people come in at this stage and they become like an advocates or contributors to the OpenEBS project, helping to improve. And then once those users get really comfortable with running, then that's when like they kind of pull in their SREs or database administrators to see if OpenEBS can be integrated into their internal platforms. And this is when like we see a phased approach of deployments for OpenEBS, where it starts with running some kind of a non-critical workloads by the database administrators or the SREs, could be like a CI/CD or like a highly resilient workloads. And then once they're comfortable with that, they get into a phase two where they provide like databases on top of like OpenEBS storage, right? We also noticed like another category of users that have come in, which are like actually other cloud service providers that tend to provide block services using OpenEBS technology for their cloud customers. So this is a typical workflow that, when a fully functional OpenEBS, the platform SREs, bring up a Kubernetes cluster and they can install OpenEBS just like any other application or like then cluster component. And then using the standard Kubernetes API, they can configure like, which of the storage on the nodes or the types of the storage that's on the nodes should be used for provisioning the pools or the volumes, and create the corresponding storage classes. From that storage classes, like the application developers just create PVCs, and then those PVCs interact with the control plane components of the OpenEBS, which are like CSI operators or like data engine operators, to provision the volume and make it available for the application. And all of these OpenEBS components, both the volumes and the control plane components, expose metrics in a cloud native way, and that can be integrated into the overall manageability or the observability stack that customers have, right? So one thing that we did touch upon is the difference between the local volumes and the replicated volumes. And this is where we are now getting into what's changed. So in fact, like with the last two releases, like the major releases, what we had supported in terms of local volumes is a host path under device and ZFS local PVs. And in case of replicated volumes, it was primarily Jiva, CStore, and Jiva is actually like a fork of Longhorn. So it's a stable engine, and CStore is based out of ZFS, which is also a stable engine. And then we started working on something called as MyStore, which was targeted at like providing a high performance distributed volumes for which makes use of SPDK and totally geared towards NVMe devices. So one other aspect in which like replicated volumes get used is like, you know, maybe using them in a disaggregated way where like, you know, some nodes in the cluster could be treated as a storage nodes or like, you know, could be designated to run stateful workloads. And because you can connect via either NVMe or like iSCSI, the application pods could be running anywhere on a fleet of like application nodes, and then they can write to the volumes that are on the storage node. Right. With 3.0, there are several engines that we have introduced. I'll get into like some of these things in the upcoming, you know, the slides that are further down. So the OpenEBS has evolved into this collection of like storage engines, you know, that are suited for different types of applications. So it's there are like two aspects that determines like what storage engine to use. One is like the needs of the application from the underlying storage, and the second one is about like the type of storage that's available to the Kubernetes cluster, right? So for example, if you don't have any disks, then it makes sense to use local pv host path or Jiva, which run on top of like host paths as well. If you have like HDDs, then CStore could be like a good one, or like ZFS volumes could be like a really good option. And if it is NVMe devices, that's where like we talk about using MyStore. Right. In addition to like these data engines, we also have made some enhancements to the control plane, or like the operational or operators that can make it easy to install and use OpenEBS. Some examples will follow. One thing to call out though here is, so we started supporting Jiva and CStore, you know, when CSI wasn't even there, using the Kubernetes external storage, and Kubernetes external storage is getting slowly phased out. And in line with that, like even the external storage provisioners for Jiva and CSI are getting deprecated in OpenEBS. There are an corresponding CSI and Jiva CSI and CStore CSI drivers that are available, and there are like upgrade operations or like the operators that are available for you to help migrate towards them. So this one lays out the comparison of like, you know, the different capabilities that each of the data engines have. I think at a high level, you need to decide whether it's a local or replicated that you need. And then within the local, depending on the type of the storage, you can pick up like the different flavors that are available. Similar with respect to like the replicated Jiva CStore or MyStore. So while there are differences in how we support, all of them support like, of course, like dynamic provisioning, and some of them are really good for performance, and some shine in terms of like the capabilities, like ZFS based ones are like really rich in the capabilities that they provide. And we are trying to like build all those kind of functionality into MyStore as well. So in terms of like the operationals or ease of use, almost all the engines support them or like are in the process of supporting them. The star here indicates like, you know, those are the planned additions that are going to come up in the future releases. So we already spoke a little bit about this, so I'm going to skip this one. This gives you an overview of like how OpenEBS local PVs are like typically used. So what we do is on the Kubernetes nodes, we install OpenEBS along with OpenEBS components. There's a component called Node Disk Manager that gets installed that has the capability to discover what storages are available. Now, depending on the type of the local PV, either we can like mount that particular storage into a path and use this as a host path, or like, you know, we can tag some of the devices and say that these should be given as is, either as like raw block devices or like a partition on that device to the workloads. And a popular option is also like creating a pool. And in this case, pool is like either ZFS or LVM, and creating a storage class that specifies which of these types of storage should be used, right? And depending on the type of the storage class selected, the volumes are provisioned accordingly. So a few things have, we have enhanced almost like all of these engines in 3.0, and key things that I need to highlight with respect to the host path local PV, especially if the host path is coming from an XFS based mount, there is an option now to enforce the quota. So prior to this, there would be a subdirectory or a volume created, and the users can write up to the capacity of the mount point that's available. But now the capacity will be limited by the PVC request size that's available. With respect to ZFS, as it's rich in its storage capabilities, we also supported like an Velero plugin that can actually help with providing incremental backups and restores. We also enhanced, as these ZFS local PV and LVM local PV are CSI, we have the capacity-based scheduling feature that's available in the CSI integrated as well. With respect to LVM, like, you know, we are also experimenting with a way of how to set QoS on the containers that uses LVM volumes, and this is done in a generic way that can be extended to the other volumes as well. So this one just shows a quick example on how to use the new XFS quota feature that we have. So typically, we create a storage class for the host path, and if the mount point is one of the prerequisites for using this feature is that the XFS project quota should be set on the mount point. And then like in the storage class, we have to set the XFS quota flag as true, and that will automatically, the provisioners will make sure like the quota is set on the PV volumes. So in terms of replicated PV, I think like the key difference compared to like the other cases, when the PV writes into some thing called as a target. In case of CStore, the target is like another pod that you can actually like use kubectl to check it out. And then the data that's coming to the target is like synchronously replicated to the CStore pools that are running on the storage nodes. So the major changes have been in terms of like supporting the CSI driver for both Jiva and CStore. And as we did that, we also enhanced a lot of capabilities in terms of like data operations. You know, for example, like one of the things, like, you know, whenever there are network failures or node shutdowns, there are possibilities that the volumes will be mounted as read-only, especially if you're using a 64 file system. And there is a feature that we have enabled which can auto-remount. And there are also cases where like if you're running on-prem, the applications that are running on the node that went down get stuck and start throwing multi-attach error. Those things have been handled with the CSI driver. With the CStore, which is basically like, you know, which has like a little bit more of higher functionality, you have to create something called as a pools. And these pools are now capable of like declaratively kind of replacing a disk, or like, you know, moving the pool to a new node if the node moves, if the node goes and the disks are attached to the new node. All these things were supported manually, but right now, via changing the YAML for the CStore pool, those are automated by the CStore operators. With respect to Jiva also, I think like it, one of the change is that it uses the, instead of using the host path volumes entry, it uses actually the local volumes, which helps to avoid cases where like nodes get rebooted and the storage is not yet mounted, which causes like the additional new host path to be created and then the data starts getting written to that one. That can be avoided by using like the host path volumes, like the local volumes, which will make sure like the replica starts only after the storage is mounted. It's again like important to call out that the older external provisioners are getting deprecated, and we want like users to move as soon as possible. As we get to Kubernetes 1.25, some of the objects used by these older provisioners will not be supported anymore. So it's important to kind of move to the CSI drivers. So I think like I've touched upon CStore and Jiva, and with respect to MyStore, we are still in beta and we are still actively developing and working through the feedback that we are getting from the community on how to make MyStore better. A key difference between like CStore and MyStore in terms of like the way the volumes are structured is that there's no target pod. In fact, like the target is embedded into the core MyStore engine itself, and that will help in like replicating to the other nodes or like other nodes where the MyStore pool is running. So these are like some things that we are like currently working on and hoping to complete the beta very soon for this project. So there are like a whole bunch of other things that we've worked on other than like, you know, enhancing like the engines, a few things to call out are the NFS provisioner. So we already have like a couple of NFS provisioners in the Kubernetes that we actually closely work with. But there's a new NFS provisioner that we support in OpenEBS, which is slightly different from the ones that are available. I'll just speak to that in a minute. And we also have a kubectl plugin now for OpenEBS and Prometheus stack that can be set up out of the box and that can give you like the default dashboards that you can probably take and like, you know, customize for your environment. So this is about the NFS provisioner. So what we have here is like, you know, we have made it easy to launch an NFS server or any block volume. Especially, you know, if you are, if you need to create like an NFS server that's per volume, this is like a really good option. So the configuration can be controlled through a storage class where you specify, actually we support only kernel as part of this beta release that we have released for this provisioner. And you can specify what's the storage class to use for saving the data. And that data could be like, you know, any kind of a PVC. So the NFS provisioner, when the request for RWX volume in this case comes in, will launch a new NFS server, and that NFS server will include a backend PVC PV that's created, and you can, and it also creates a PV object that is pointing to this NFS server that can be mounted from multiple pods running on multiple nodes. All right. So these are like some examples, some really cool things that are there in the CLI. Example, like there are multiple engines, so the OpenEBS command has been enhanced to show what engines are really installed in the cluster, and we are kind of increasing them to include other engine supports as well. So if you have used CStore, I think like one of the painful processes is to create the CStore pool config. We are hoping that that will get improved with this CLI as a first stage. Like, you know, for example, like we need to identify the nodes and the devices which needs to be used. And this is the first command that we have, which is OpenEBS get block devices or BD that shows what are all the devices that are available and in the cluster. You know, it's a tree of like node to the devices that are there. And it shows like, you know, whether it's already mounted or not mounted. And for CStore, we need to take those devices that are like unmounted or like, you know, without any file system. So this helps in getting that very easily instead of like using a kubectl command with a lot of greps and all that. There are like multiple commands that this CLI provides. I highly recommend to check it out. Like, you know, this is an example of how it displays the status or the health of CStore volumes. It's pretty cool to kind of get the consolidated output of the various objects that are involved in the CStore. It really helps in troubleshooting and like knowing the status. Talking about status, like, you know, this is another way. So we can set up like a monitoring dashboard. It's delivered as a Helm chart, and it's also available as a Prometheus mixin. And it has like some set of default charts that have been loaded as well. This one shows like an example CStore overview chart that shows like, you know, what the consumptions of the various pools, the status of them, and the volumes that are provisioned on top of that. All right. So that's what we have in 3.0. And these are some of the things that we are working, as I said earlier, like master beta is something that we are actively working towards in the 3.0 timeline. There are a few features that have come in from the community. You know, we are engaging like the CNC of mentees as well to work on some of these features. And yes, so the XFS quota and like the part that we have about the dashboards, even the CLI, and there is also a feature on the Kubernetes policies. All of these have been made possible working with like the mentees, that students from the CNC of mentorship program. So a huge call out and a thanks to the people that participated, Parth, Rahul, Nivedita, and Almas, and really great to work with like the new set of mentees right now on some of the projects that I'm listing here, So just to pick on like one of the features that we are adding, and we really look forward to contributions and feedback on these features. So what we have learned from the community is that the storage can be connected to the nodes via some kind of a SAS interconnects, which makes it possible for the devices to be visible on multiple nodes. So in this case, even though it's a local storage, that storage is visible on like all the nodes that are in that cohort, if you will, or like a storage pack or a set or a domain. So now when we use like a shared device, we can create a volume on one of those devices. Specifically in this case, we are looking at like shared volume groups that have that capability. And if that node fails, so the application pod can move to any one of the nodes that's there in the storage pack or the storage cohort, if you will, and that can connect to the same block device that it sees for that's connected to the other nodes. Just extending that and also like, trying to come to a solution that's somewhere in between like MyStore and the local volumes is this solution where we want to put an target, which is what we already have in the MyStore. On top of these local devices, we could actually run those targets on multiple nodes. So makes it possible to create a multipath volume that could be running on a remote node, which is not connected to the storage pack. And then when a node goes down, the client-side initiators can make sure like, they connect to the active path. And when it comes back up, there is no need for rebuilding kind of technology because it's all on the same device. The path becomes available. So these are just like, a few of the different volume types that we are trying to support. We started with local PV and we had like replicated volumes at the extreme ends. Now we are like trying to create like two more types of volumes depending on the new topology that we have discovered, which is about like the shared devices that can work. So this is I hope you learned something, and we really look forward to you trying it out and shouting at us with your feedback. We are available on the OpenEBS Slack, and there are like contributor meetings that you can join. You can also participate in the mentorship programs that we conduct, and we really look forward to talking to you. Thank you, everyone, for taking time today and learning about OpenEBS.